Bill carried in the tea things. His hand shook a bit, so the two dainty cups rattled in their saucers. Sometimes his shakes were so bad that the lid of the pot rattled too, beneath the thick woolen cozy. Bill hated that his hand shook, but in all the years he'd made tea for Mary, he'd never spilled a drop. Mary stood in the dining room, watching the storm through the window. Beyond the thin glass, rain battered down the flowerbeds and roses. The wind seethed and howled round the apple tree, its ancient branches creaking. The sound sent a shiver through Bill. He quickly placed the tea tray on the table. Mary turned from the window. She was a small, bright-eyed woman of 71, a handkerchief stuffed in the sleeve of her cardigan. She nodded at the plate on the tray.
"The doctor said I shouldn't have biscuits."
Bill shrugged.
"That doctor doesn't know everything," he said. "You don't have to have one."
"You can't have them all to yourself," pouted Mary.
"Now come on, give over, let me."
He knew better than to get in her way. So while she took charge of the tea, he moved over to the window, gazing out on the gloom and grey. It felt good to be warm and indoors with a storm outside. At least it ought to have felt good. But something troubled Bill. He could just make out a sound like grinding teeth out there in the darkness. At the end of the garden, the knotted apple tree bent against the wind. Its branches, he realized, were creaking. But no, it wasn't the apple tree creaking. Out there, in the dark, there was something else. Someone knocked hard on the front door.
Thump, thump, thump.
"Bother," said Mary. "Look what I've gone and done."
Bill turned from the window, heart hammering in his chest. Mary had spilt some of the tea. She was already on her way through to the kitchen for a cloth.
"I'll clear this up," she said. "You see who it is."
"Could be anyone," he said.
Their little house was 3 miles from the village and a long walk from the main road. She turned in the doorway.
"And they'll be sopping wet. Towels on the top shelf of the cupboard."
She stopped, seeing the look in his eye.
"You all right, dear? What is it?"
He wanted to tell her what he'd seen outside, but he didn't know what he had seen, so how could he describe it? For a moment, he was more scared of her laughter, that she'd call him a silly old fool. Again, thump, thump, thump on the front door.
"You can't turn them away," Mary told him. "Not on a night like this. I'll fetch more cups."
So Bill made his way to the front door. His hand shook as he raised it to the latch. The hairs on the back of his arm stood on end. He could barely catch his breath as he opened the door to the storm. He gazed out onto the night. For a moment he couldn't see anything, just the rain-slick gravel pathway that led through the garden to the wooden gate by the apple tree. The rain fell, the wind whispered around him, nothing else. And then he saw what he'd seen by the apple tree, the thing that had knocked on the door. It was on him before he could scream. Doctor Who, The Empty House, by Simon Guerrier. Read by Raquel Cassidy.
"All right!"
yelled the doctor over the storm. He clutched the lapels of his tweed jacket indignantly.
"Very clever, and very rude as well. Smacking my TARDIS off course. But all right, okay, you've got my attention. Who are you, and what do you want?"
The howling rain did not answer. A tall, pretty girl joined him in the doorway of the TARDIS, the doctor's impossible space and time machine, which from the outside looked like a police box. Amy wrinkled her nose at the bleak, dark countryside. The rain lashed down. A gale whistled past them. It blew her long red hair across her face, so she had to sweep it out of the way with one hand. "You know," she said, shivering with cold, "I don't think there's anyone out there."
"What?"
said the doctor loudly, talking to the storm as much as to Amy.
"Something hit the TARDIS. Something big and powerful. The controls are all still sparking. What else could it have been?"
Lightning flashed, brilliant white in the darkness. There was a great rumble of thunder, the storm right over their heads. The doctor grinned, his eyes twinkling.
"Oh, yeah, all right. We could have been struck by lightning. I don't think that's happened before. Still,"
he went on, looking out into the darkness,
"something isn't right. I can feel it in my elbows."
"So, we've landed in a storm then," said a voice behind them.
The doctor whirled round to stare in amazement at a tall, bewildered young man in a checked shirt. It was Rory, Amy's husband.
"How could you possibly know that?" the doctor asked him.
I looked out of the door," said Rory.
The doctor looked back outside, at the rain battering down into the muddy field.
"Oh," he said.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.